In this video, we are going to learn top 10 efficiency boosters for leaders and managers. These cover four aspects of being a great leader: execution, collaboration, analytics, and communication. Let's take the first situation: booking your time. Your time is valuable. Probably you have an assistant to manage your calendar. Fine. But let's take a common scenario. You're the boss. You have 20 people reporting to you. Every 3 to 6 months, you have to do appraisals with them. You have to sit with them one-on-one and look at their performance. Very common activity. Now, those 20 meetings, your assistant is arranging. And to arrange those 20 meetings, so much time and energy is wasted. So, there is a better way. Make sure you use bookings. Suppose your meetings are going to be 30 minutes. So, you define a time slot of 30 minutes. And then your entire calendar, you don't want to show people about this. You're going to say, okay, in Monday morning, I'm going to keep, say, 1.5 hours. And Friday evening, 1 hour. In these 2.5 hours, I want to manage these time slots. Now, it'll give you a link. Just send that link to all those 20 people. Each one of them can click on the same link. They will see the available slots. Now, if someone chooses the slot, your and that person's calendar is blocked. Everyone gets a meeting, and the next person to click on the same link will not see that slot. So without any interference, without any confusion, time slots are blocked completely under your control. It's like booking a movie slot, but for corporate purpose. This can also be used for external customers if you want. So think about it. Do you have salespeople who are managing key customers? They can also use it. Your procurement department can also use it with suppliers and so on. Bookings has many other aspects to it. To understand it in detail, have a look at this video. Next one is meetings. All the time you are doing meetings. Now, do you take notes in every meeting? Maybe not. You know, important meetings, critical meetings, I'm sure you take notes. Now, the question is, when you take notes, 6 months later, can you find those notes? It's difficult. So this is the way to link notes to meetings. Now, of course, this requires Windows, desktop, which has Outlook and OneNote installed. Most probably you already have it. When you're in the meeting, go to calendar, find the meeting, right click on it and say send to OneNote. Now Outlook will talk to OneNote, create a new page. It will ask you which notebook to put it in. Now that newly created page has all the meeting details. You just take notes there. Meeting is finished, close the OneNote notebook. That's it. It's auto saved. Now 6 months later, go to calendar. Finding the meeting in calendar is easier. Now right click and choose the same button. Now Outlook remembers which page it is. It'll simply open it for you. In fact, OneNote is not just for taking notes and linking to meetings. It is a great product. It's a very powerful tool for many other things. I also have a very popular video about how to use OneNote, best practices. Have a look at that as well. Now as a boss, what do? You don't do your work. You get it done by someone else. I'm not saying you don't do any work, but a lot of managing as a boss is getting the job done from your team. That requires delegation. Now, most probably, you are sending mail to delegate work. Send a mail saying, on 15, do this. Now, on that 15th, are you going to remember? Probably not. So now you or your admin assistant is creating another Excel file to keep track of these mails. You are just complicating matters. There is a better way of delegation. First step is to go to Outlook task folder. Outlook task folder. Second item is actually the task folder. First one is to-do list, which is different. That's flagged emails. Don't go there. Now go to task folder, create a new task. You can put the task and the deadline. But now you want to tell Outlook, I am not the one who is going to do it. Someone else is going to do it. How do you do that? So look at the button, assign task. And now put the email ID of the person who is actually supposed to do it. Now what happens? Like a meeting request, task request. So that person clicks accept. It becomes a task in that person's folder. Eventually, that person is going to finish it, then you will be notified. So now what happens, when you go to your task folder, you can see your task as well as delegated tasks in one place. And if you have enabled reminder, you will not get the reminder. The person who is actually going to do it will get the reminder. Isn't that brilliant? All this is great, but suppose you want to look and say, okay, I have delegated so much work. Have people done it or not? Now you don't want to see your work and delegated work mixed up. No problem. Go to the View tab and there is a special view available called Delegated or Assigned. That will only filter the delegated work and it will even group it by person concerned. This is a brilliant way of managing delegation. It's already there in Outlook. start using it. Now, this is just one part of managing tasks. There is much more to it. I have a very popular video about managing tasks, my tasks, project tasks, delegation, all of them put together. Have a look at that as well. The commonest habit bosses have is to send a mail to many people saying, what is happening? Kya ho raha hai? Updates de do. Now, this is the way to do it in a stylized manner. It's a new feature and I'm sure you already have it. This is there in Outlook, desktop as well as browser. So what do? You create a mail. Now I'm creating a mail right now asking two people about some updates. So what am I asking? Wait, before you start typing your questions, look at the menu on top. There is a special button now called Loop Components. Yes, it's a really powerful feature. Open the drop-down and choose Q&A. Now it'll add a loop component and it'll allow you to type questions. So one question I'm asking, how much is the target completed? Okay, next question I'm asking is, what is the pipeline for next quarter? And the last question I'm asking is, are there any pending customer issues? I put two people's names in email. I just send the mail. That's normal, that's usual. So what's special so far? Nothing. Now let's look at it from the other point of view. One of that person's opened the mail. Yes, that person can see all the questions. Most probably, what is that person going to do? Click on reply. Now that is what you don't do. You no need to reply. The person types the answer there and then in the mail which is received. And now whatever this person is writing, you can see it. Wait, this is one person replying to that message or that question. Now the same mail has gone to another person. Oh, no problem. When that person answers these questions, you will also see them merged in the same mail. Now imagine the amount of convenience and simplification of collaboration. Amazing feature. Start using it and make sure everyone down the line also starts using it. It'll revolutionize the way you communicate. The fifth one, it's a related feature, but this is more structured. We often need updates on a regular basis and you have a proper form for it. Right now I asked random questions and they were answered. That's okay for ad hoc. Now I have a project update which should come every month and there are people from whom I want to accept it. Now every month what is happening, either I have to remember to ask them or they have to remember to send it to me. And even if everything happens correctly, after 6 months, those updates are randomly lying in my inbox somewhere. So disaster. So what should I do now? Go to Teams. In Teams on the left side, click on the three dots and add an app called Updates. It's a brilliant app. You say new update. There are many templates available. You choose the template you want or you can create your own. I'm going to choose the project update template. And now I'm going to say, okay, these people are going to give me updates. It can be one-time update or it can be recurring update. I'm going to say monthly. And that's it. Now I send the update. Those people will get a notification. They'll get a reminder also at the end of the month. And then when they provide the update, I can see them at a glance in the update app itself. It shows me all the received updates. It also says, do I have to give updates to someone in one place? And this will go on and on and on. And you can have customized templates exactly as per your business requirements. Now, if you want to consolidate that data, behind the scenes, it uses Microsoft Forms. So you can go to Microsoft Form, export this to Excel and analyze it further. It's a brilliant way of communicating in a structured way with your team without overloading anyone and without using email. Try it out. Exactly how do you work? Do you know? Who is observing? Are you observing? No. Microsoft is observing. No, there is no privacy issue. Remember what we do every day. You get up, you log into Outlook. You attend meetings, you chat, you send email, you send attachment, you share files. All that is your work. That data is already there with Microsoft. And Microsoft uses it, applies AI to it, and actually tells you how you work. And that brilliant feature is called Viva Insights. How do you find it? Go to office.com, log in using your corporate ID, click on these nine dots, and then you will see all the apps. One of them is Viva Insights. When you go there, it shows you many things. I'm going to show you two things. You can explore it on your own. It allows you to look at how you manage your meetings. For example, it takes a 4-week window, that means last moving window of 1 month, and it says, okay, these many meetings you have attended, and it gives you brilliant statistics about how those meetings happened. All kinds of statistics it gives you out of the box. Now remember, you can see your report. Nobody else can see your report. So looking at Viva Insights, you will actually understand how you work on the ground, and that will give you ideas of improving the way you work, the type of work you do, the ways in which you can improve work-life balance and make it better for others as well. The seventh item is about analytics. Now, when you are in the meeting room, you are in a review, people are going to show you their reports. Maybe they are already copy-pasted in PowerPoint or something. Now, when you look at the data and the reports, obviously you are going to ask some other questions for which the reports are not yet ready, because you looked at the current reports, then you got a thought in mind and you say, okay, this I understand, but now you get filtered by that region, or merge this product and see what happens. Problem is, when you ask a new question in any meeting, what is the answer you get? Most probably 100% of time, I will get back to you. Now what happened? You have to wait for 2 hours, 2 days, whatever it takes, but there and then the decision could not be taken. So here is the best practice where you don't have to do anything. Ask people to go to powerbi.microsoft.com and log in using your corporate ID. Download Power BI Desktop and tell them you are already making reports in Excel, the same data you import in Power BI, and come with a blank dashboard. There is no need to learn Power BI or create a dashboard in Power BI. It's blank. It just has the same data for which you already have made Excel reports. That's it. And now when you ask a question, go to the insert menu. You insert a visual called Q&A, question and answer. And then you type the question there, and it actually answers your question. So either you learn it, or you make sure your team understands it, or ideally both, because when you have the data, why do you need a team? You can ask the question yourself. Try this Q&A out and tell me whether it worked for you. I have a separate video for AI features in Power BI as well. Have a look at that. Similar question arises when you see a chart. This is a simple line chart, and anybody is bound to ask what happened there, how this became half in 1 month, what went wrong. Now to answer that question, currently what are we seeing? The dates and the amount, that's all. But if you look at the data, there are so many other parameters, fields or dimensions already there in the data. Now what is the answer you are going to get? You know the answer, I will get back to you. So now why that decrease? That explanation will be some report someone will give you, but tomorrow, day after, no. What do you do? Right click on that point and say analyze, explain the decrease. Now Power BI will look at all other fields, rank them in the order of influence, and give you nice waterfall charts. So what is it showing? This was previous, this is current. That difference is explained by various things. So now first will be one parameter, second will be second parameter, and so on. So you can actually see that same decrease explained in various ways, which may give you some ideas or help you come out with different kinds of action points. It's a very empowering feature, not just as a boss, but everyone in the company should ideally know this. Now the next one is interesting. Very often you get a lot of reports. Now if you see one chart, second chart, third chart, fourth chart, and lots of long pivot tables, even if you are the expert, even if you know your business well, understanding what exactly is happening across so many charts and visuals is difficult. Especially if one chart is on one slide, another is on another slide, business is same, underlying data is same. So here is another use of Power BI. What do? Ask people to create a simple report in Power BI. So this report has a couple of charts, one map, and so on. I have a special visual in Power BI, insert visuals, AI visual, smart narrative. Just click on, make sure there is some space for it. And then it'll actually interpret what is going on across all these charts and give you the interpretation. And not only that, you can customize the interpretation. And going beyond that, remember, everything in Power BI is interactive. For example, now I use this as a filter. Now this is filtering all other charts. So even the smart narrative will change itself to take into account the current filter. So it's dynamic smart narrative. So make sure you have smart narrative in every dashboard or report you see, so that everyone in the room or everyone who is looking at it, the chances of them missing something important goes down. More informed decisions. Again, come to the same thing. And finally, you are the boss. Your communication matters, because the way you communicate is going to affect all your staff and your customers and your external interactions. There is a great feature in PowerPoint which many people don't know. As a boss, of course, you have seniority, experience and all that. But Maybe nobody told you that when you are presenting, something is wrong. Who will tell you? You are the boss. Of course, technically speaking, you can hire a professional coach to improve your presentation skills. Maybe, but everyone has not done that. So here is your presentation coach. In PowerPoint, there is a built-in feature which uses AI to analyze the way you present and give you suggestions. How do you go about doing it? Step 1. Open a presentation which you are familiar with. And then go to PowerPoint, go to Slideshow menu and say Rehearse with Coach. Nowadays, it also looks at your facial expression, your body language. So make sure you enable the camera. So what is it going to do? It's going to wait for you to present. So this is a presentation. You assume there is an audience in front of you and present as usual. It's just a mock presentation, rehearsal. There is nobody in front of you, but you try to be as natural as you would be on the stage. There is an option at the bottom when you say start. Do you want live input? So while you're speaking, it'll give you inputs. I don't like that feature because while I'm rehearsing, it should be as realistic as possible. In a real life situation, nobody is going to tell you I'm stupid. So I don't want that thing to tell me. So disable that feature, just start the rehearsal. Just finish your rehearsal and at the end of it, it is going to give you a brilliant dashboard which will give you so many useful information. It looks at how fast or slow you speak. It also looks at, is it the same monotonous pitch or you are varying your pitch? Are you too slow, too fast for people to understand? Now many people, when they are thinking, they say, like that. So filler words they are called, or some people are used to using the same word unnecessarily. For example, now, definitely, something like that. Irrelevant words, but it's a filler. That also it'll catch. In fact, many a times, we are not very good with our pronunciations, especially in a multilingual scenario. It'll actually tell you your pronunciation of this particular word was wrong. Below that, there are many, many more options, including body language. Now, if you keep looking here and there, scratch your head, keep looking down, it is going to notice that and say, no, maintain eye contact for better communication, and so on and so forth. So it's a wholesome experience. Even if you're the best presenter, I am sure you will find one or two things which will enhance your presentation further. So with that, we come to the end of our top 10. I hope you found this useful. And finally, if something doesn't work or you have some questions or you have some ideas, no problem, put them in comments. I'll be happy to answer them. This is all based on Microsoft 365 platform. It's a very powerful platform, but you should know how to use it well. So I have a video for that as well. Have a look. So with that, we come to the end of this top 10, but see you next time very soon. Thank you.